Meeting together. This is a special meeting of the Board of Directors discussing the preliminary 2019 business plan. Welcome, everyone. The media, we do have our Village TV, which is on now, caught us unaware, but we're on TV. And could I ask for an approval of the agenda?
So moved.
Second? All in favor? Thank you.
I did get a second.
Thank you. Chair's remarks. This is an interesting meeting. It's such a good meeting because we're going to have the information we're getting today is a result of many, many meetings and discussions. And we get to take a look at some of our accomplishments from 2018 and then get a look into what's going to be going on, what we're looking toward in 2019. Member comments. Any members that would like to come up and make a comment? No member comments. So now we will go to item 6 on the agenda, discussion and consideration, review GRF 2019 business plan version 2, and that would be our CEO, Brad Hudson.
Thank you, Madam First Vice President, members of the board. Always a pleasure to be here and to talk about the many good things we're doing for the community. I want to start by thanking you for all the work you've put in. It's many, many meetings. Thank also the corporate members who've been more than willing to give their input, and then residents who have attended various meetings as well. And so when you put all that together, it makes my job pretty easy, and your clear policy direction has been vital in our formulation of these policy documents. So I thank you very, very deeply. Before we kick into sort of, you know, what we want to do for next year and how we want to pay for it, I thought maybe we'd just hit a couple of the highlights from this year. There's been so many good things happening, and many of them are just now getting going. I don't have pictures of those, but I did want to hit a few things here. And this is just kind of a summary of the pictures. Here's a number of HVAC projects, recreation projects, just a number of things, efficiency projects. So I'm just gonna whip through these, and we all have seen this picture before, and it's quite a success story. We hired probably the top company in the world that does this, and there's a reason for that. And you can see it in the constructed surfaces that are now available for villagers to enjoy. Again, this one's been a challenge lately. This Historical Society HVAC and roof replacement, and so that was completed. And we have a number of other HVAC projects that are underway, including this building, Clubhouse 6. And there are many, actually further on in the report, the Performing Arts Center. Many of these units have been pressed into service maybe a little further than their useful productive life, and so their replacement is critical. These gatehouse renovations, which I know we'll be talking about, we're almost done renovating all the gatehouses, and our plans are over at the city for the gate arm technology. And so we anticipate moving forward very aggressively with that once the city has approved those documents. If you recall, you've already selected the vendor here in a previous solicitation, so California Gates will get ripping along as soon as we can get approved documents. So, you know, this is kind of a favorite for me because I've started this right after I got here, and kilns are pretty hard to get, and they're pretty hard to install, and it's taken a long time, and we had to replace the roof on the building and a number of other things, but there they are. They're not functional yet. I think they just arrived in the last few days, but they're being installed as we speak. The new roof has been put on, and there's just a many, many good things happening at Clubhouse 4. We schedule all the work there when Emeritus is out for the summer, and so we have 3 or 4 different projects going on simultaneously over there. Why we have this break in the action. You've all been to Village Greens and seen the upgrades there, and I think it's a much better environment. Still a few things left to do, and we'll continue with that. This is on the left, the bridge room where we upgraded the kitchen there and made it much more functional. That's a very busy clubhouse, and the bridge room is a big reason for that, and so we wanted to make sure we could accommodate our residents and guests there appropriately, and I think it's a great project. This one we just did the other day, and I asked for this several months ago. Those meeting rooms over at Clubhouse 2 were acoustically horrible. You just could hardly have a conversation in there, and so I'm sure the architect's intent was good. Hey, let's keep a nice hard surface there so they'll always stay clean. We got some little kitchens there, but in practice, it was not very functional and actually was disruptive to many of the groups that met there, so I think that's a big upgrade. We're going around doing a lot of water-efficient landscaping, particularly at the clubhouses and at the gates. You'll see both gates 10 and 11 getting a little new landscaping that's more drought tolerant and featuring California natives. And so that's coming along, and we've done it many other places. Gate 12 will probably be the next one you see. They finished the gatehouse there, and so they'll be redoing that landscaping at that entryway. Here, and this is more a sample of the proper way. If you look on the right, that would be improper. Putting signs in the landscaping, number one, it's difficult to trim around them, and when they break them, it's a big, elaborate thing, and so the one on the left is the proper way to put these signs in the proper location, close to the road where people can see it, and if they run over that, we just pull it up and stick another one in without any crews coming along. So that's the way most municipalities are doing it, so you'll see us switching those out slowly throughout the village. Here, somebody had mentioned this to me right when I got here, but it was about gate 5, that's all messed up over there, and you can't get that right turn because everybody's going straight and blocking it, and so I took a look at it, and many of you don't know, I'm actually a traffic engineer as well as many other disciplines in both engineering and math and science, and so I talked to Ernesto, and he said it was a good idea, too. And so we changed gate 5 to make that right turn dedicated coming out. And it worked so good that we came across the way and did it at gate 1, 2. And it's just a big traffic improvement and makes things work much better here. You know, we've done a lot of technology projects. We probably have less, really, in this budget than we've had in the previous budgets, because we have quite a bit stacked up. Chuck's to-do list probably has 50 or more projects on them and touching every department, every function, and we are moving aggressively on all those. But a couple of the ones I really like is having these MDCs in the security vehicles increases their efficiency probably more than 50%. And also it's much safer when they're going to a manor or addressing an issue. They can pull up the resident data. They know who they're supposed to be contacting, what they look like, what their previous compliance issues may have been. If there's other issues there, if there's a caregiver or other things, they know that. They have it right in the vehicle. It's so much better. Just like any municipal police department would have. They don't go out there naked like they did, you know, in Mayberry. You know, they'll send Barney. He'll be okay. No. They have all the data with them when they get there, and so our officers will have that as well as the capability to do their reports in the field, which is very critical. Having them drive back and forth and be in an office someplace doing reports when we want them on patrol is a very inefficient use of an expensive resource. If you have a mobile resource, you want to keep them mobile, and so that's what we're doing. And this next one is kind of a step in the right direction in terms of digital inclusion in the village and introducing all of our residents to the technology that's available. And so we've added some iPads in the library, and the response has been very positive. We added the new resident queuing system. This is sort of a temporary here. We actually have a kiosk that's coming in that we're just kind of piloting through this. We anticipate that it already has been a huge success. We're seeing residents quicker. We have metrics for how long they're waiting. Before, we just really didn't know because they just got in the line or sat down there, and We got to them, Now everybody's served in the proper order, and we know if there's, you know, too long of a wait over in manner alteration, so we need to get some more resources over there to help those people. And we can look back historically and compare data and how we're performing, which is very important as well. And then we did an antenna upgrade as well. But, I mean, for technology initiatives, I could spend hours, Chuck could spend days, sharing with you all the things that are underway right now. It is a very robust collection of important projects that touch every department, every aspect of village life, and we're very lucky to have that young gentleman here. So with that, I'm going to jump into the business plan, and I congratulate you. That's just a very small sample. If you look in the GRF project log, there's probably 50 or 60 active projects on there. That was just a taste. Now, for your annual meeting, we're going to prepare a kind of a looped presentation that maybe would be showing during the entirety of your luncheon, going over projects and programs and things that you've been working on. So I think that'll be nice for everybody to see. This is just a kind of an illustration of, gee whiz, we've had a lot of meetings on this, and we didn't just show up today and tossing this out there. There's been a lot of input from every corner of the village, and it's all been respected and taken seriously, and much of it incorporated into the documents you'll be seeing here today. In terms of putting a budget together, you know, I love our department heads. I think they're great. And they think they're great too, and are worthy of much more additional financial assistance than sometimes I would like to provide, or our residents for that matter. And so as we get these requests from departments, you know, I have to prioritize them and kind of make sense of it all. And so when we look at that, the number one priority does it provide enhanced direct customer service? That's kind of the guiding principle here. If it doesn't really help residents too much, my interest level is not peaked. And so we look at that first. The next level is, well, can we save money on it? Does it help us become more efficient so that we can have additional resources to do something else for residents? And so that obviously gets a pretty high mark. And then investments in technology, which almost always assist in the other two, becoming more efficient, and then providing better service to our residents. And then lastly, you know, that shouldn't be lastly really, because those are more operational and tends to be a little more reserve oriented, how much improvement can we make to the facilities? There's been a lot of deferred maintenance over many, many decades. And so how do we prioritize those? Which are the most important? Which are the easiest to do? Things you can knock out without a lot of staff resources that will make an improvement in residents' lives. And so kind of that's kind of the thought process I go through as I'm looking through a various budget requests from a department. On the highlight side, you're seeing, as you've seen for a number of years, your non-assessment revenue is increasing. There's a number of reasons for that I'll touch on in a bit. I'm suggesting 14 additional positions. You know, we've cut back a lot, and you'll see in the next graph kind of where we've been on staffing. But certainly, our landscape situation in the village is much more complex, more of a mutual issue, really. I mean, you have landscaping as well, but theirs are more pronounced. We have a different kind of a grass that grows here now. We have a different kind of water that's going on it. The weather pattern has changed. We're not getting, and when you use reclaimed water, you need a lot of rain to leach the salts out of the soil. And when you don't get a lot of rain, and it has to be dispersed as well. And so it's a very complex arrangement that is going to be more difficult to manage, and we're going to need more people to manage it. That's plain and simple. And so I have a number of positions there. We have a couple security positions, which are desperately needed, though I think with the MDCs, we're going to have much more efficiency out of the officers we have. And then we have, I think there's a position in compliance and then some in resident services as well, where you would think, and I mistakenly thought this before I instituted my first effective call center that, well, there's a pent-up demand for services, and then once we plow our way through that, it will level off. And that is completely false. The more responsive you become, the more requests for service will come in because people believe that you'll actually do something. And so they call more, not less. And so Chris and I are both aware of that and fully prepared to deal with that, but it takes a few more people to answer those phone calls and to provide those services. Assessment increases are really quite minimal, like in a 1% range, well below the CPI, which I think you saw for the last month in Orange County, I think was 4.1%. So we are well below the CPI, as are all the mutuals as well. And so I think that just illustrates how conservative our budgeting and spending principles are. And I have some more examples of that there. And for the first time ever, you adopted a five-year CIP. I'm getting some cutout on this mic. Is it okay over there, Chris?
Yes.
All right. Maybe it's me. Which you know, having a 30-year plan is kind of a distant planning horizon. It's hard to make meaning out of that sometimes, except for the fact that by statute, you're required to have one. So you have one. It's not useful, but you have one. You're required to. A five-year plan is a short enough time frame where you can get your arms around it and make sense of it and start phasing projects and doing other things that make sense for our community. So I applaud you for that effort. And then this will show up later as well, but your CIP for this year is $3.1 million less than your reserve plan. So what does that mean? Well, your reserves are going to grow. You're going to have more in reserve than you anticipated under your 30-year plan, which, again, that's conservative budgeting, as I would expect from this group. This gives you a sense of staffing levels, and you can see in 2010, we had 764, and probably the high watermark there might be in 13, where maybe we were close to 780, and with the additions I'm suggesting today, we'll be at 741. So we're still down a bit. Most of those positions are in landscaping, and so that's something to consider. We've done a lot of things to become much more efficient in landscaping, but I don't think many of those things have improved our landscaping. Matter of fact, I would say some of them have made it worse. And Bruce and I don't agree on all of these things, but I'm not a big fan of the large mulching mowers, particularly in the smaller landscaped areas. They create a mat, and it's a harbor diseases and causes problems. Water has trouble penetrating to the soil. And plus, now you're dealing with cucuyu, which doesn't really chop up into really small pieces like fine rye and fescue. It's a big, thick weed, and it doesn't biodegrade as quickly as some of these other species. So something to think about, and I know Bruce is working on a whole array of new landscape techniques, which will necessitate some additional landscape equipment that's not really in this budget that we'll need to talk about later because we haven't fully characterized that yet. And so we'll probably come back after discussion with the mutuals about what their needs are and talk to you about how we might address that in the future. This just gives you a quick staffing summary. I think it shows the two positions in my office. Those folks, that's not two new positions. They're already here. I had, believe it or not, borrowed a couple positions from empty positions from other departments and put them to my own use. And those departments had suggested I give those back. And so I have now put them in the budget. And so that would be Eileen's position and Whitney's position, which are obviously desperately needed. So, and you see the resident services position, landscape. Those are where the meat of this is. A couple in security, and then just a summary. And again, this is highly preliminary, but you just want to get a sense of how your assessment fits in with the mutuals, and so you can see here the increase that I'm suggesting today is about $4, and it's about $5 in in United, so there would be a total of nine there. Again, that's very preliminary. They're going to act tomorrow on their budget, and so there's still room for everyone to work. Again, this is version two, but that's a little bit of a misnomer. It might be like version 10, but we call it version two, simpler. And then third, you can see it's like a similar effect. They're about $9. So $4.26 again from GRF. And I thought this was important and also an explanation. You can see in 2007, the assessment was $2,002, and in this year, $202. And I did that twice, I think. And then in 2019, here we are, $202. So, gee whiz, have you not experienced any cost increases or improved services in any way during that period? Well, of course we have. Assessment is a small part of the resources that you have. Not a small part, but a part of the resources you have to address community needs. And the big thing that has happened in between here is, number one, the facilities fee, which allows you to reserve a little bit less since you have that fee in place for capital improvements. And then the other side of the coin on operations is broadband. You know, we had, 1,000 internet customers probably in 2007. Now we have 10,000. And so those revenues have increased. Likewise, many people have made the choice to upgrade their TV service in their manner through augmented services, which we also count in our revenue picture. So you can see, certainly the, four years before the transition, assessments were higher. And now they're lower, and there's reasons for that I just explained, and there are others as well. The board's been very responsible. And when you look at our total expenses for this year, you'll see later, we're spending less this year, 2019, than you spent in 2015. And we're doing so much more, so many more projects. Recreation programs have been dramatically enhanced. Security services are greatly enhanced. The things that you're responsible for have been dramatically improved, but it's not really costing the residents any more in terms of assessments. And you can see that highlighted in the bottom line here, which is, and this is in thousands, so your total expenses in 15 were $32 million and change, and then in 19 plan that we're suggesting today, $31 million. So we're doing all these improvements, fixing all these buildings, all these facilities, gatehouses, you name it, we're trying to fix it. And I did commit to you when I got here, we're going to fix everything, and we are going to fix everything. But we're doing it in a responsible, conservative approach that isn't going to put too much pressure on our residents. And so I'm committed to that. I know you are too, and I think we've lived up to that, both historically and certainly with the plan before you today. May I just touch on a couple of these things. Many of these aren't too remarkable on the revenue side. You're pretty aware of this, but we are budgeting trust facilities fees flat. Probably be hard-pressed to make that $4 million number in the current year. I think there's not that many units for sale. And so we would need to have a pretty good fourth quarter to pull that off. We'll see how that goes. You can see your rental and event revenue. We're doing a lot more. We had a slight increase in room rental fees last year, which is attributable to some of this. But there's just a lot more activity going on out there that generates revenue. Same thing with broadband. You know, we're offering the whole home DVR, and we've got dramatically upgraded internet service now. And so there's things going on that drive that revenue in broadband. And then, of course, miscellaneous revenue is, again, I won't hit every one of these. They're not all worthy of discussion. But this kind of gives you a sense of where your money comes from that is not assessment revenue. So you can see the trust facility fee and broadband services constitute the bulk of that. I do have to say the golfers are contributing pretty heavily to their activity, which in terms of real estate values benefits every resident. And on the expenditure side, though we're adding positions and we've given raises for the last, you know, we have a negotiated union contract that provides a couple of percent every year for those employees. Nonetheless, our employee compensation isn't much different than it was in 2015. There aren't too many companies, certainly in California, maybe the country, that could show you something like this, because the labor market is so tight, it is hard to find people to work. And so many companies are responding to that by offering more compensation, more benefits, you know, relocation, housing allowance, you name it. We haven't had to resort to too much of that. It's tight, but I think we've done better as of late in terms of recruiting workers to come here. But that's a pretty good line in an economy that is very robust and growing rapidly with almost zero unemployment functionally here in Orange County. I just highlight the things that I think are kind of interesting. If you have any questions, please, I can elaborate. Community events, again, we're spending a bit more on that. And there's good reason. I mean, you've got a lot of events you didn't have before, like a Cinco de Mayo event or a big Fourth of July event. There's many such events that are well received. We just did the hoedown in the spring over at the Equestrian Center, which was very well received. So yeah, I think it's not a lot of money, but it's a lot of bang for our residents who enjoy these events and getting out and enjoying our facilities.
Brad, I think Judith has a question.
As a joke, you said you were having a hard time finding people to work. Have you gone out on Ridge Route over there, that community with all those people need a job? That we have,
yeah. Well, we'd like them to be qualified. That'd be helpful. I mean, it's just a tough environment right now, particularly everywhere in California. I mean, everywhere I go, I see a sign up, help wanted. And I just heard that In-N-Out is now paying $18 an hour for folks cooking hamburgers. $18. So that's what you're seeing right now. It's that kind of economy. It's just really rolling. How much longer it will go, I don't know. My tendency generally is not to knee-jerk to this sort of thing. And in a few areas, yeah, we'll contract it out because we just can't find the resources to do it in-house. And that's not a bad idea either.
The other part of my question, Bert told me that we're having trouble getting landscapers and their union. Is there a reason for that?
There aren't enough of them around. They can work it in and out now for $18 an hour, and we pay them $14 in air-conditioned environment, free hamburgers. Yeah. And also, let's face it, a lot of our landscape labor has, you know, an immigrant quality to it. And so you've seen, particularly in Mexico, but other South American countries, their economies are developing a little bit now, and there's not really the kind of immigration that you've seen in the past. It's really trickled down quite a bit. And those that are here legally and that are working are making more than $14 an hour. And that's just the state of our economy. That won't last forever. And we have contractors that are more than willing to fill in. And you might see the Ridge Route work going on, or there's going to be some fire fuel reduction work in the west side of 3rd. Those are all contracted resources that are going to do that. In the past, we've yanked our landscapers off, but we're very uncomfortable to do that right now. And so having these contract crews assist, particularly during this busy time, is a very cost-effective and reasonable way to approach that. Again, nothing too remarkable here. It's noteworthy that our electric bills have gone down a bit, even though the rates have tickled up a little bit. And I think most of that is due to the LED lights and things that we've put in. There's certainly more to do, but that's a good start. Let's see any of this stuff. I thought the telephone is worthy of mention because you can see how much that's gone up. And it's going to go up a lot more. because we're putting, we've got mobile devices in all of the plan-a-ride and all the buses now, so they know where to route these things. We've got all the workers in the field have mobile, not all of them, but they will. The supervisors and the leads will have mobile devices in the field so they can do online paperless work orders. All that sort of communication is going to raise that line. Now, it's probably going to drop some other lines more dramatically than this increase, and so that's the plan. I thought this was noteworthy. You can see our fuel and oil expenses have dropped quite a bit, and I think that relates directly to how we're handling bus routing and not using, you know, huge buses as much for you know, plan a ride. You know, transporting one person on a big giant bus is not very efficient, so we've tried to discontinue that. And then you might notice the legal fees are up a bit, and that really reflects VMS legal costs. This is a contract year for labor negotiations, and my anticipation is that we will, it's not an anticipation, we will need additional labor legal counsel services, and that cost is reflected there. I'd highlight the income tax on this line. Again, used to pay $500,000 in income tax. When I got here, I put a stop to it. We started allocating those costs differently, and now you don't pay that anymore. So hopefully that survives audit, Betty. Yes?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. We did it. And then insurance costs, they've gone up a bit, but given the exposure here in the environment, I think it's been very reasonable. And then probably maybe one of our biggest areas of exposure is programming fees for Village Television. Cable television is a little bit like fixed route transit use. It's going down dramatically. Millions of customers lost every year. That leaves these programming conglomerates with fewer and fewer customers to spread their costs on. And so we're seeing, you know, double digit, even worse, 50-75% increases requested by some of these folks over a 3-year span. And it's just, it's something we'll have to debate, and we'll negotiate as hard as we can. But, you know, when NBC or Fox says, here's how much we want for you to carry our stuff, they don't leave you a lot of room for negotiations. They might give you a few event tickets or take you out to dinner, but they're not lowering the price much. And so it's a very difficult. Most of our contracts are negotiated through a sort of an association of small cable companies, but there are a few that we have to do ourselves, and they tend to be the more difficult ones that won't refuse to negotiate with the association, because they want to stick it to us all individually. So that's something that to keep an eye on, and you can see that's been a steady march, and I anticipate that to increase as fewer and fewer cable customers are available to spread those costs and to get the profit margin they want on that programming operation. So I think that concludes the operating piece. I'd answer any questions you have about that, and then I have another 2019 capital plan proposal I want to share with you.
Dick.
Yeah. I'd like to mention about the air conditioning in this building. I went to the pre-construction conference. There were three contractors, and I asked one, he claimed that he can save time and money, and I asked him, how is he going to do it? He said, that's a secret. Well, when the bids came in, I couldn't believe it. He's going to install all the roof equipment in one weekend instead of stretching it over 3 years, which to me is remarkable. And he's going to spend his crew's going to work overnight to handle all the ductwork and everything else. So we're going to end up with not only a quicker solution, but a much better system. And I think the energy costs are going to come way down.
We're wasting a lot of energy here with this inefficient system. And this will be a tricky coordination. I mean, I would say Ernesto's on the line here, because they're not waiting until the winter or something, because they're going to flip the switch on this, but the equipment's coming from Mexico, where I think it's train equipment that's been spec'd, and I think that all comes from Mexico, so we have to make sure it arrives here, and then there's a big giant crane that has to be here to put them up there, and you wouldn't want the cranes here and not the equipment. That costs you an extra several grand a day. So there's a lot of coordination, and so we're excited to bring that and to not have any disruption in this building. That's the big part.
I just have a quick question, Pat English, 2022D. I wonder, Brad, if we go back to the previous chart, we've got outside services which are increasing like 500,000 from 2018 to 2019. If you could give us a brief synopsis of what that would cover. Thank you.
Thanks, Pat. That's a good question. We talked earlier at prior meetings about a change we made in the reporting of some services that Chuck has for broadband. And he moved them out of a category called cable T programming and into outside services where they belong. And those are various HITS fees, transmission fees, and so forth that weren't the actual programming contracts. So about $350,000 moved into line 18 outside services. So it's not the big increase that you see budget to budget. It's just a reporting change. So the actual increase is for the cable TV programming fees, although it looks like it's only up $72,000. Add that $350,000, and there's a big contingency there for these programming increases that are expected as these contracts get renewed for the channels that are not in that cooperative.
Thanks, Betty.
Okay.
I have something here along the line. You know, we're talking about the landscape situation, and we get constant complaints. It would be wonderful if we could explain to everybody with a brochure or something explaining exactly what you've just put out. We don't have the manpower. We can't get it because of the cost factor. I do things around my house to help them, as I mentioned yesterday. Because of the fire situation, I pull away all of the pine needles and such. Maybe if some of the people could do some help themselves without creating a challenge. But I believe if we let them really know, we have a great bunch of guys, but like you say, they can't handle everything. Just as an aside, I'd say that 90% of my front yard is beautiful. I've got a 10% section where it's absolutely brown. The guys are working, trying to do what they can, but they can't be there every day. We have to understand there are challenges involved, and you put things out good. I would just think it'd be even better if we could put it out in a brochure of some kind, so everybody got and understood why. Thank you.
I recently wrote a piece, which I think, Javon, I think you read it, that's going to be going into the breeze next time, that basically explains exactly what Brad has talked about. So it'll be out into the community.
Everybody doesn't read the brief, register. What I'm saying is that
if we had some kind of a brochure that was sent to each resident, I know it'll cost money, but if we send it to each resident and make sure that the resident owner gets it to the lessee and the renter, because we're running into problems with them not getting information.
Just a thought.
Yeah, it's a complex problem, and there are many faces to it. I hit a couple of them, but I think one of the biggest ones, and some people like to hear this, is we have never been required to manage the turf here. They just mow it and water it. They've never tested it. They don't verticut it. They don't aerate it. It's not managed. The golf course is managed, and you can see the difference in how that looks versus your manor turf. We're going to have to start treating, because with the kind of grass we have now, which, by the way, is the same grass you basically have on the golf course, it's all gone kikuyu too. That was a function of the drought. It pretty much overtakes any grass it runs into. And so we're going to have to start treating these manors and their landscaping a little more like the golf course, you know, testing the soil, putting in growth regulators, doing all these things that, to make sure that we have the right environment for turf to grow properly, particularly Kikuyu, which is takes a little bit different technique. So it's there's a lot of reasons. I think we've done a lot of good things already, mainly relieving the landscapers of duties like cleaning off garden villa breezeways or cleaning carports, or in the past we had 20 landscapers out there cutting that fire break out there and taking them off the manors. We can't do that anymore. So our landscapers, they just do landscaping, and that's the way it should be, and we're going to train them to manage this valuable turf in the proper way, because it's never been done here before, ever. And it probably didn't have to be. You had 100 more landscapers, you had better weather, a little more rain, and so you could roll through this, and if you had a problem, you just threw enough bodies at it to attack it. Well, we don't have that many landscapers anymore, and you can't wait till after the problem happens here, because the problems are different and they're difficult to solve. So it's just a different way of looking at this. Bruce is, and Siobhan as well, used to manage the turf at the Rose Bowl, gee whiz, and the golf course surrounding it. So I we got some people here that know how to manage high quality professional grade turf, and not saying we're going to get that, but we can get close to it. And we're committed to make that happen, but it's going to require some equipment we don't have now, some chemicals we don't use now, going to require us to stop using some of the chemicals we're using, which I don't think aid in the attractiveness of our landscaping anyway. And so there are a number of changes that have to occur. They're kind of radical, and so I wouldn't say we're going slow, but we're being thoughtful about it.
Maxine McIntosh, 68C. I'm so sorry. Couldn't get out of the dental office on time, or I would have been here on time. So now I need to know, have you already covered the remodel of the Village Green of the cafe? Okay. I'm trying to remember, without having my notes in front of me, how long ago that was constructed and opened for business. Has it been about 12 years?
No, maybe 7 or 8.
Maybe 7 or 8. All right, my question is, why does it need remodeling so soon?
I think you're speaking about the agenda for the MNC meeting this morning. That was on the agenda for this morning. It was discussed.
I think they were talking about the kitchen this morning, not so much the work that was done.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know. If you get 7 or 8 years out of a restaurant chair, I think you're doing okay. And I mean, I just couldn't leave those chairs in there any further. And then that was the bulk of that project was really chairs. We did a little bit of cabinetry and some painting and carpet, but it, I mean, there was a lot of chairs. And so...
We addressed that this morning.
Okay.
Yeah, so this packet was not for today. This was for this morning.
No. What you're looking at...
Well, it's in the business plan packet.
Yeah, those are things that have already been done. So
we've
already done that.
I was going to say, I saw beautiful new chairs.
Yeah, no.
In the dining room. Beautiful. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Barbara Copley, 410D. I guess I'm just as confused as Maxine. Are you responsible for the upcoming proposed enlargement of the kitchen at Village Greens?
No, that was discussed this morning at the MNC.
I'm not asking that question. Okay. Isn't GRF, aren't they responsible for that building?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So don't you have to somehow think about where that money is going to be planned for?
It's not really proposed, though. It's just something some people were starting to talk about.
Oh.
But I don't think there's a proposal.
We had a discussion, but no action was taken.
Well, yeah, but it's it's out there. So you're not ready to do any planning for that financially. Is that what I'm getting?
Right. That the discussion this morning was about that, and we said it would be a good idea to look into it a bit more, but we really didn't.
So in 3 or 4 or 5 months, if MNC comes to you and says, okay, we have a plan, this is going to cost X, Then what do you do?
We'll put it on an agenda.
Yeah?
Well, then it would go to finance after M&amp;C anyway.
Well, yeah, but eventually it's got to come here. So my point is, there's no plan out there, except I assume you have reserves. You have some reserves?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. But my thought was, and I don't know if I'm speaking to you correctly, that since it is a business, it might be good to think in terms of having the rental that we get from that go towards paying for that kitchen enlargement. It's just a thought, as Ray says. But we shouldn't be having to pay for this business to be making more money. That's my point.
Judith.
We can't talk about the contract and any monies in the contract.
I'm asking you to, Judy.
But, no, I understand what you're saying. So I just wanted to make that clear. And the other thing is, if we were to enlarge the kitchen, like it's being speculated, it wouldn't be 2019. It would have to wait till next year, 2020.
Annette.
I believe that when the 19th was open, that it was originally supposed to be just for breakfast and lunch. And through the needs that have evolved through the usage, it's become more of a dinner place, and there's a lot of other extra events that are housed there. So in terms of, like, the 2020 budget or whatever, it will come up, but it takes time to go through planning.
Yeah, thank you. I was on that committee with Jim. I've been around here a while.
We discussed that, too, this morning, yeah.
Would you like me to go through the capital plan proposals? Again, this is exactly as I presented to you a few weeks ago with one change, and I had talked to both Tom and Judith about this. We had originally planned for two minibuses for next year, and I'm suggesting I think that's how many big buses you can take out of service. I'm suggesting let's take them out of service if we can and get them off the road. Fuel savings and driver efficiency and all that. I think I've explained this before, but, well, first of all, you know, the buses are typically not full. They're very, you know, lightly filled, and those buses carry with them a lot of federal regulation because of their size. Drivers have to have certain certifications. There's all kinds of inspections that are required. Some of those buses get inspected 3 or 4 times every day. When you relieve somebody for lunch, the relief driver has to inspect. When the new driver comes back, or the driver who's at lunch comes back, he has to inspect. All these inefficiencies that are built into that. And so with these smaller buses, you don't have that. Plus, they don't use much fuel, and they're much better on the environment. And they can wiggle up in a cul-de-sac and get somebody right in front of their manor, too. So there's a lot of advantages, and so that's the only difference. So I just want to go through this really quickly. Here's your planned expenditures. Equipment fund, $3.3 million, and facilities fund, $5.5 million. I'll go through the details of that. This is sort of a breakdown of, vehicles are a pretty good piece of this, the Performing Arts Center, security is a big piece, and golf and paving. Those are your big five areas of expenditure. Here is your basically planned expenditures for your 5-year CIP, and you can see in 19 your CIP, and what we propose today is $3 million less that's in your reserve plan, and so you can anticipate that your reserves will be $3 million more than what you anticipated, which having extra reserves is a good thing. And then sort of here's sort of the proposals, and I didn't go down to every penny, but these are the biggies. Obviously, Performing Arts Center, and we're really talking about, and the biggest piece of this is the HVAC, which is a very inefficient. That'll probably help that electricity cost as well, Richard.
Yeah.
Yeah, having an air conditioning unit that only cools the parts of the building that are in use. That's a nice feature. There's also a lot of ADA accessibility, fire life safety components that need to be addressed. There are some, and these are minor costs in terms of the overall scheme, but some deficiencies in theatrical equipment, including sound and some of the video equipment. And then we're talking about lobby and dining room upgrades. I suspect the dining room upgrades will look something like what we just did at Clubhouse 2. You've got the same problem there, where all, it's all hard surfaces, only they put a little bit of carpeting on the walls to buffer that sound. And so we're going to take the carpeting off the walls and put it on a floor where it belongs. And so we think that's going to help the sound quite a bit there. Acoustically, those are rough. I think those rooms could get a lot of good use for a lot of different things, but the acoustics are so bad. And it has the original sound system, too, which reminded me of my grammar school. It's the same kind of a system that they used to use there. You can see the panel on the wall. But and get that replaced. Those will be very useful rooms for a number of functions. You couldn't really have a lecture, and it's hard to have a big meeting in there because the acoustics are so poor. So that's kind of what's going on with the PAC. And then I think these are in order of expenditure level. A lot of vehicles, primarily vans and buses, and we've got a lift here, and then there's a number of other items as well, scrubber, flatbed truck. We still are a little bit on hold with our tub grinder. We're in the permitting process for the existing grinder. I think that we're going to exceed the useful life of that tub grinder before our permit application is considered, so which would be a good thing because then we could just buy the new machine that would be compliant and not have to worry about it. But I wanted you to know that is a $200,000 expenditure that's hanging out there that we haven't reserved for yet because our anticipation is we'll get that permitted. But it's lasted so long now, I don't know. Maybe it's time to buy a new one. But maybe put that in the 20 plan. So I just wanted you to be aware of that big piece of equipment. If you recall, we had an inspector who did a stop work notice on us using that grinder. And so we accumulated quite a mountain of debris and material from our landscaping operation. We brought in a contractor, and they have mobile units are not regulated as tightly. And so he brought his mobile unit in and created all that mulch for us. And then we got a new inspector who said, oh, no, you can keep doing that until why we review your permit. And so we're back to using it now. So we should have some word about our permit application, hopefully by sometime in 19. So that's where we're at there.
I just had a question about the passenger vans. Are they all for the transportation of residents? There's other
no.
things we trans. Okay,
that's no. Some of them some are for transportation of employees as well. And then security, again, here we're talking about moving security into this building, co-locating them with their other pieces of the department, which is social services and compliance, as well as making this really the emergency operations center for the community. And part of that, a big part of that, would be moving security dispatch to this building and really integrating them with resident services dispatch, because security dispatch is resident services dispatch nights and weekends. And so we need to make sure they all have the same training, they all know what the heck they're doing, and that they can use the same equipment. And so all that's coming into play. And then we have a very old dispatch system. I mean, it's right out of Mayberry, and we got to get rid of it and go with a modern computer-aided dispatch system where the dispatcher knows where everyone is at and who is closest to the scene and not otherwise occupied and can dispatch more directly to a single unit instead of, you know, calling all units, you know. I mean, that's just not the proper way to dispatch. So all that is going to be cleaned up as well. And there's some money in here for dispatch consoles, software and equipment that lets all that happen on the third floor here. And so our backup generator, hopefully we'll get it at some point. I think it's scheduled for 20 at this point. All that can be backed up properly. So in an emergency, we have security dispatch, we have resident services, you know, we have security, we have everything ready to go to assist our residents. And so that's the proper way to do it, and we're moving forward accordingly. And there's been a whole task force that's been working on these things as well. So we're moving forward. I strongly recommend that. And then we've got a number of, again, I talked about this in your last meeting, just having the, what we used to call in city business, a corporate yard. We call it the maintenance service center, but it's where all your equipment, all your supplies, your gas and fuels and pesticides and everything you have are kept there. And so to have that completely unsecured on nights and weekends is not a best practice at all. And in fact, things have come up missing. We have contractors and folks coming in on the weekends, dumping stuff in our dumpster. So a lot of that, now we've put a halt to a lot of that as Chuck has installed a number of cameras everywhere. And so we've pretty much caught everybody who's doing anything now. But the next phase, that would be to secure this. And so there's three projects, actually two for the service center and one for RV lot B. Again, it's asking an awful lot of our residents to pull their RV up, you know, get out, take the lock off the gate, push the gate open, pull their RV, get out, shut the gate, lock it, go park it, and do what they're going to do, then come back and repeat every time they want to get in and take a peek at their RV. The other RV lot isn't that way, and this one shouldn't be either, so we have that right here as a gate replacement as well. So it's just the right thing to do. Last year we raised their rates a bit, still the best bargain in the area. But I think we committed to do this, and I'm suggesting we should.
You know, being we're making a lot of changes over there, just a thought, we have so many commercial vehicles and people complaining back and forth, the outside resident vehicle search. I'm wondering, would it be possible to take a portion of that area, put a gate, like you say, the control gate, rather than lock on it, use part of that area. It would give us money. It would take care of a lot of the challenges we have in here for the parking situation now. Just a thought. I would like that to be considered. We could really do some good with that and get some good benefit money out of it. Just a thought.
I just met with a resident a few minutes ago who was cited for a commercial vehicle and didn't know when he bought the house. And so it is a challenge. And people are working longer now. Many of our residents are still working, which I don't think that was the case several years ago. But a lot of them are working, and a lot of them have commercial vehicles. And you know, I don't know what the immediate answer is. I know in the past we put some of that in the RV lot, but then you were squeezing out people with boats and RVs. So there's got to be another solution out there, and I'm sure we'll find it.
I just have a clarification. So just to secure that yard across the street, $248,400.
There you go. Yes.
Those are three gates. All right.
That's not so much the gate. It's the technology. You got to bring fiber there, and you got to have the swipe, card swipe, and all that stuff. That's always the case. Just like the over the tennis thing where we put that in. Yeah, the gate was, you know, $3,000, but all the stuff that Chuck put in there was a lot more, including cameras and things as well, which this has as well. And then golf facility. There's a number of golf facilities that we're looking at. Probably the most pressing is the driving range, which is kind of an embarrassment. And I understand when this was originally constructed, that it was kind of an in-house sort of deal. And really what has to happen here is you have to have a civil engineer look at this and give you a grading plan, and then you have to follow it. And that will allow your soil to stay in place so you can actually grow grass there. Right now, the topography is such that you can hardly plant anything there, and all the balls roll down almost onto molten. It's just not a good design. I can envision some PCM employee on a bobcat out there grading that site, and it's really not the proper way. And so we're suggesting let's get it done right and once and for all, and not have all of these soil and turf issues as well as drainage issues, you know, every time it rains out there. And then we have another number of other ones. And here we've got 950 fairway irrigation heads that need to be replaced. That's a pretty expensive deal, but needs to be done. This is the, and this is really a no-choice item here. You've just got a lot of violations down here in this golf maintenance facility. It's just, you know, it's old and it hasn't kept up to modern workplace standards, and so we need to fix it up. Then we've got some equipment, mowers and different things. I like this picture of this yardage marker here. It's a little hard to see, which is the point, I guess. They're pretty old and hard to see. And so T-signs, yardage markers, all that. Very small amount of money in the scheme of things, but a really big boost for those who play golf. And so I am suggesting that. And then this kind of your more your standard stuff, your asphalt and your seal coat and curb gutter sidewalk. It seems, and I suspect it's the public works director in him, but I think Ernesto tilts pretty heavily towards more overlay and maybe less slurry seal, and I can't disagree too much with him. In a rainier place, maybe you'd do something different, but he really is putting some emphasis on that, and that's good. And then we've got a pretty good allocation here for curb gutter sidewalk as well. There's a lot of improvements that are needed out there and repairs to existing improvements. And I think that paving crew is a pretty good example of a turnaround in an outfit that we were working when I arrived here in 16. We were working on 2012 and 13 tickets. And now we're almost through 17 and into 18. So and it's been literally 1,000 tickets. And these aren't things you can fix in a few minutes. You know, you're talking concrete here. Yeah, you can grind some uplifted sidewalks and do some other things, but a lot of this is remove and replace. And so they've just been going through it, and it's really a success story. And hopefully they'll take this $200,000 and really make a lot of residents happy with it. And then here, again, we have a lot of tech projects that you've previously funded that are still in the works. Some of these take many years. This is another one. This is your fiber network calibration, which, as Chuck says, you need to do every 2 or 3 years. It hasn't been done since 2008, and so it contributes to some of the difficulty that we have with our network, though it is greatly improved. You know, he just completed an upgrade. You approved this funny money a couple of years ago to upgrade our fiber network. We now have an 8 gig fiber network. Maybe it's even more than that, but it's like an 8-fold increase over our 1 gig network that we used to have. And that was through the lasers and a lot of the work that he's been doing there. So you've got a huge capacity now. So if everybody in the village wants to watch Netflix at 6 o'clock on Friday night, we can handle it, I think. Don't try it. Anyway, the capacity increases are astounding. And so this kind of fits in with that. Faster, bigger. Yes.
We are still having problems with the Netflix, and I keep trying to hold my son down when he gets so excited. Could our modem be kicked? Our modem seems to be kicking our router off. Should I have my modem checked?
Well, you should be. If you haven't got your modem replaced, you're entitled to a free DOCSIS 3 modem through
West
Coast Internet.
Well, I called and they said I have that. So
you
I
have that? So well, maybe it's not a very good one. That happens.
So I can have them come and look at it?
Yeah, have them come and look at it, and then I would make a service call and have them come out and check your box. Because, you know, there was a plan where we talked about this, you know, doing the vaults and then the nodes and then the boxes. And there's a reason for that. There's, you know, maybe, I don't know, 20 or less vaults, but there's like 32 nodes and there's thousands of boxes. And so then those affect fewer units. Obviously, your box might affect everybody in your building.
They can't check that remotely. So
probably not. They probably need to come out and look at it.
Okay, because, yeah, we have bad Wi-Fi, especially on weekends is what I'm saying. Yeah. And I thought it was because more people are using it and not enough people got rid of the analog TVs yet.
Well, that's still happening. though I haven't seen a lot of analog TVs out by the garbage cans, I suspected we would see that, and it hasn't been the case. But the significant that getting rid of those analogs, calibrating the network, upgrading the nodes and the vaults, providing the lasers, all those things are just, those are normal sort of maintenance things that should have been going on for years. It just weren't, and sort of doing them now. And it probably didn't matter. When you had 1,000 internet customers, who cares? You know, even a outdated, poorly maintained fiber optic network will support that. But now you throw 10,000 customers on there, 28,000 devices, well, now you've got a different story. You have to manage the thing or it won't handle that kind of volume. So that's what Chuck's doing, and I think he's doing a bang-up job at it. There are going to be some growing pains along the way. There's no question. And we're hearing from residents when that happens. Can set top boxes, that's something that you're used to seeing, and other miscellaneous equipment. And then miscellaneous projects here, which is pretty consistent, and equipment. I did want to, I think that's just about the end, but one miscellaneous project that they're working on or going to start working on is the design for the gate arms at gate 10. So that, I authorized Ernesto, I think the design is around less than $10,000. And so while the gatehouse has been rehabbed, as well as 11. I think 11's a little more complex. There's more options there to review. We've elected not to put gate arms at 12. That's, you know, deemed not necessary. Personally, I don't even think a gatehouse is warranted there, but I lost that argument about a year ago. So we have a gatehouse, and it's newly remodeled. So get the design on gate 10, and then by the time they're through with that, we'll have a lot of experience with the other ones, with the phasing of the other gates, and so we'll come back with a real cost. I mean, some of this, they're all completely individual projects. Gate 4 isn't going to be like gate 1. We already know that gate 4 had bootlegged electricity. It never had legal electrical service, just like gate 6. And so there's a complexity that you have to deal with Edison and getting new service to a facility and all that sort of thing. So they're all a little bit different, but I think after we do one or two, we'll give you an exact number of what that'll cost, and either we'll have savings along the way, or we'll come back and ask for some more money to do 10, because I know you discussed that at MNC today, and that's an important gate to get done to secure the third community. So we don't want to leave that out. And I know it kind of got wrapped up with this whole merger of the gates, and that plan was abandoned. And so, again, I have resources available to fund that design. And so we'll just go ahead with that and then come back to MNC and see what you guys want to do. This is the generator that backs up our entire service center. Your fuel pumps, all your stuff out there, your lifts, your just everything that runs security, everything out there. And I think it's an 8 kV generator, which is slightly less than what's required. So we're going to upgrade that a bit. That just has to be done right away.
Have we investigated solar plus batteries?
Yeah, I don't think for this one. I think on this one it was just, let's get something that's suitable. It's not particularly expensive, and let's get something in there.
I don't know, 150K is.
Yeah.
I think we ought to at least take a look for it. Well, Bill, you're out there, the Energy Committee?
It's a task force.
Yeah, I'm a little reluctant to.
I think we need this rather quickly.
You can get it rather quickly.
I'm just saying.
We can do whatever you want. My experience with emergency generators like this is that for the most part, where we're at today, diesel is your best option. I don't advocate diesel for much of anything. Certainly not for buses or anything that you're going to use on a regular basis. But for backup generation, reliability, known technology, I think we did put the one for this building on hold, because it's going to be
Yes.
a monster. And we could integrate it with maybe some other activities we're doing here. Matter of fact, you might even do a grid or something here with the facilities we have. The potential up there, too, maybe for a grid at some point. We've got an array of facilities.
I mean, it's a shame.
We did put this one on for 2020 in order for the security to move into this building and contemplate everything else. The other one, like you said, is an emergency need, and the chief, you know, and you have spoken about what you're doing with it.
It's a shame to essentially invest that amount of money and have it sit there, and for 99% of the time, it's doing nothing. Whereas if you go to a microgrid, basically use solar and battery, then you're using SCE as a backup, and you're getting the energy from the sun for free.
So since I'm on the Disaster Preparedness Committee, and we talk about this in every single meeting, we keep waiting and waiting for the generators. So it's the first I've heard it's been put on hold, and I'm sure Tim will bring that to the next meeting. So if we have an emergency or power outage this week, since this is going to be the operating center, emergency operating center, I don't know, are we going to be okay?
Well, you have a
relatively
new, I mean, when you compare it to this, generator out here, it's just undersized. And so the thinking was, and it's always subject to change, of course, particularly change generated by this board, but that we would relocate that undersized generator to a clubhouse or clubhouse 5 or 1 or wherever would be the right place to put it. We haven't studied that yet because it's still in relatively good health. Ernesto had written in here, and I took it out. He said, replace the feeble 20-year-old unit. And so I took feeble out. I thought that was a little too dramatic, but it is pretty feeble, and so I know they were concerned. If it's the board's decision, if you want to go ahead and approve the funding and then direct us to work on rapidly on this other investigation, but I wouldn't want to leave it hanging out there too long, have something happen, and then we can't fuel our vehicles.
So we've been waiting for a price also, so that's, or I have. So the $150,000 would get us the size we need for this building.
Not this building. Not
this building. No. This is for the service center.
Service center only.
That's for maintenance.
Oh. Okay. So what about the one for this building? What would that, is that supposed to cost?
Oh, I think that's on the order of
$350,000.
They've got $350,000, but probably more.
$350,000. Okay. Thank
you.
When we get done with that.
Yeah. It's usually about $1,000 a KV, I think, is what I've heard. That could be going up, though. You never know. Depending on where these are made.
Do I have to introduce myself?
No.
Okay. Bert, you've got a consulting contract with Tech.
That's correct.
You could go to them. This
is already a high priority item that we defined at the meeting.
Well, they're sitting there waiting for something to do. I mean, if you want to find out about a microgrid and a battery system,
right,
then go to them. But, you know, they should be able to turn that around. They should have the expertise and know, you know, what the track record of this technology is and whether it, you know, it's a viable, if it's a viable thing for, so you'd have to define your problem and what your use is going to be. And
I have already been in touch with Chief Moy because he's got to really define what it is that he needs operational in the event of an emergency.
Yeah, but
and since the security people are moving over to this building, we really don't know right now what the load factor is. So that has to be evaluated by the consultant. And that's something that I have asked Ernesto put in the priority number one.
I mean, you have expertise out there that you can call upon.
Yes, absolutely.
If that's a roadblock, I don't know if there are other factors involved in this, but that's what I would do.
Yeah,
I
mean, we've got to know what the energy requirement is going to be for this building.
Right. But you would have to know that.
Excuse me.
Not this building.
We're not talking about this building at all. This building's on for 2020.
I'm assuming you're talking
there
about,
you know what the energy requirement is.
You're talking
is.
About the maintenance.
Yes, absolutely.
And you want to put a microgrid there.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'd love to.
We could reallocate that.
They should be able to look at the electrical bill. They should be able to scope out how much capacity you're going to need. And give you an idea.
I mean, I've basically said to Ernesto, I need this.
Anyway.
I'm going to call this meeting back.
Okay.
Okay, go ahead, Bert.
Again.
I have three people waiting.
Okay.
And then.
Okay, security meeting is, our committee meeting is Monday, August the 27th. Now, we're only talking about the transportation one that we talked about on the, that we were just, I'm sorry, the service center generator. If you would like to go to the energy committee only on this generator now and get whatever you want to do and bring it to the committee meeting on the 27th, by all means do that so the chief and I could react, we could discuss it there. But we're not talking about this building. We have to wait until the security moves in and we see, we reassess the needs and everything else. That's where we've been on this through all the committee
meetings. I have asked that we invest. Well.
All right, so if you would like to go to your energy task force about the service center generator, the $150,000 to replace the 20-year-old unit, to figure out what it does and get back to us with all that information on a quick turnaround for that Monday meeting on August the 27th, please feel free to, okay?
Again, this money is for 2019, so, and we're not gonna spend it all on January 1st, so we have time to investigate this. I would suggest, if you think it's an important project, let's allocate the resources, and then we'll figure out the how-to through these other bodies that are investigating solar and other technologies. I think that's fine.
The highest priority that we at the Energy Task Force have given for GRF has been to look at GRF facilities, in plural, okay, to look at the possibility of replacing the existing power sources with a microgrid and using SCE energy as backup. So it's not only looking at the service center, it'll be looking at this building, and it'll be looking at any building that the task force that you're working on has defined as a building that is going to be required for an emergency.
Okay, Jim Batson and then Jim, your hand up.
Pardon me?
Your hand was up. Earlier, I know it's kind of loud, but your hand was up? No? Jim, do you hand? Both of those hands were off. Okay.
We'll proceed on here.
My name is Rhoda Lindner, 2013C. I think that this maintenance service center issue could serve as a pilot or a possible microgrid solution. That if that can work, then it makes sense to look for bigger projects. I think it would be very good to just get right on it and see if it could work.
I don't know if I could respond. There are already numerous microgrids, even in Orange County. So I think the pilots are out there. We don't need to build a pilot here in order to determine the effectiveness of a microgrid. It's just a matter of determining what the energy source KW is going to be, okay, and what the batteries are going to be and what the costs are going to be.
What I meant was the necessity for dealing with SCE on this. That is an issue that we have to deal with as an individual place. And it doesn't matter how well microgrids work elsewhere.
Yes.
Okay, if we can't work it out with SCE, which usually we can't, I think that would be
a very difficult problem. Correct. That's why we hired the consultant.
Yeah.
Because they do have experience working with SCE.
Okay. But I think that this could be seen as a pilot for the whole situation. And then later, if that works, then we could move on in 20.
Okay. Brandon.
All right. I showed you this picture before. This is the welding shop, which really isn't a shop. It's kind of an open air work area. And as I said, we don't think arc welding in the rain is such a good idea. And so we're suggesting a metal building here that would make this compliant with current workplace safety requirements. Again, we're here. This is a request by Waste Management to reconfigure our outdated horse manure dumpster location, which is probably a regional water quality control board violation anyway, so we probably just ought to do it. So we've got a couple of those out there that we're correcting this year. This is just another one that has to be fixed. You know, when you have longstanding business practices and you're not familiar with regulatory requirements, is sometimes year after year you just do the same things that are non-compliant. I think that's been the history here, and so as we get into these things, we find things that need to be repaired or done differently, and this is one of those. And then we have a number of aquatic, more chairs. They did some wonderful chairs at the pool at Clubhouse 1, both high and low, and I know I've had a lot of compliments from residents on those, and we have more to do. And we have some pool and spa heaters. Most of our pool covers are pretty much have exceeded their useful life, and so we've got a number of them here for replacement. Again, those are obviously aid in retaining heat in the pool and lowering our utility costs, but also keeping debris and other things out of the pool, lowering our maintenance costs. So those are good investments. And then we have a number of lawnmowers, which we'll probably have further discussion on with the committee, Judith, and, you know, in terms of what our needs are moving forward, because they're changing a little bit. And then we have the tennis building. I had proposed doing this a couple of years ago, and when I thought it would be under $25,000 and we could just do it, but when we actually got in there and started looking at it, it's in very bad shape, and there are a number of deficiencies, including having the ice maker out in the sun. It's not a good place for an ice maker, I want to tell you. So there's just a lot of things that have to be moved around. I don't think there's any air conditioning in there, and so we'd probably put a split in. I mean, there's just things that have to, it's not good. So it turned out to be a bigger project, and so it requires inclusion in this plan and obviously your concurrence. But again, I thought it was going to be smaller initially. And then here we're adding the records management module to the on-base package, which is really our document archives and storage software package, and so this would be part of this overall document records management initiative that we've kicked off a couple of weeks ago, and that is so important. We're generating so much material, and it hasn't been historically managed very well. The first part of that is, where are all the records? And then the second part is, how many of those do we have to keep? And the third part is, okay, we kept them, what do you want to do with them? And so all that is being coordinated by Siobhan and Whitney, and we have a couple of consultants that are working with us on that. And it'll require this board and the others as well to take numerous actions as we go ahead and implement some of these records management strategies. So it's good times. And then we got some commercial equipment, appliances at Clubhouse 5, and I think that's about it. So that constitutes the $8 million or so that is suggested from your reserve funds, which, again, is $3 million less that's in your 30-year plan. So, again, a conservative approach, building reserves, taking care of community needs. I think it's a good way to do business, and that's the way we've done business in the last few years. And I just applaud you for your policy guidance and the ease with which we were able to complete this budget. With respect to the generators, I think, again, these are kind of next year projects. We certainly have time to look at alternatives, but I'm not sure I would put them off too long. But I think we can certainly by the end of the year get an answer to those questions. So with that, I would recommend that you all nod your head and say, yes, we like this. And if you do, then we'll bring you a resolution at your next meeting. If you don't, then you got to tell me what you want to change. So that's where we're at right now.
I move to accept staff's recommendation for the 2019 budget plan.
The motion is to accept staff's recommendation for the 2019 business plan. Discussion. Ray.
I was in charge of the communication system for the fire department for 2 years. I would like to suggest with Bert and you that when the control system comes in, that a secondary backup unit be available to be used in the event that something happens to this building where the generator is not sufficient, whatever the case may be. Just a thought. That's what we did, and it worked out very well because we did have a couple of times where things went completely out. And you must, the most important thing here, the rest of this building can be black, but the security is the most important thing in this building because of people's lives. That's just my thought.
Yes, thank you. Brad? These old eyes are having trouble reading that tiny print on the red high wedge. What does that say, the largest one, on the breakdown?
On the cap?
Vehicles.
Oh, vehicles, okay. And by the way, I think that is good news that you've caught up on 4 years of tickets in less than 3 years, 2.5 years. That's wonderful. And I was glad to hear about savings based on the consumer index pricing. I thought that was very good. I am concerned, here on page 15 of the capital plan proposal for 2019, it shows a tennis building, renovation of a tennis clubhouse. Now, I see at least two people here who were here when the tennis courts were moved and built new, and that tennis clubhouse was built. And that's a lot newer than Clubhouse 1. I don't see anything in here for Clubhouse 1. We're talk about not keeping up to modern standards. We're falling further and further behind on Clubhouse 1. And the tennis clubhouse renovation, I would think, could be put back while we take care of a much, much, much older clubhouse and start work on that, whether it's phase one or phase A or whatever. Not put it off till we suddenly have $10 million to do it all at once, but start now. I was hoping you people would bring that up. And then the buses. Brad, you said the only change you were recommending over version one was four of the smaller buses instead of two, correct? By the way, I hope all of you realize, some of you have been through this budget program a number of years, that you can always change anything, and this is version two. You can always make a motion and change or alter something in any way. You don't have to just, you know, pass it along. But with the buses, I am concerned. This morning I was riding a bus that started at Clubhouse 1 at 10 o'clock. When I got on the bus, there was one seat left, and we hadn't left Clubhouse 1 yet. I was the first one to get off. I thought I could walk home, and it just got too hot, so I rode it for four blocks. So when I got off, no one else got off. There were two seats. I have no idea how many people got on that bus further down. The bus driver said that bus is usually always quite full. So if you ran into that, what would you do with a smaller bus? You know, this is a full-size bus. So there are concerns there. With broadband, I'm worried that we're going to start getting a lot of complaints, especially by our more vulnerable part of the community, about the change in trying to adapt to a box with one of your analogs and your own high-definition TV working with the new system. I don't know if all of you have looked at those new program schedules that show where you find the channel you want. I wanted to hear music 50.25, I think, the other day. And I was told the little dash would work as a decimal point. It doesn't on my high-definition TV. So I had to click 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 25 times to get that channel. Now, I could have gone backwards from 50 25 times. But unfortunately, I think it was chamber music. It's in the middle. So there's something going wrong, or there's not quite, nothing's been mailed out to residents, or I missed that mailing about what to expect with the new challenges. And I hope that in trying to add a whole lot more space with broadband, that we aren't going to cripple people who do not adjust well to major changes anymore. I know two women on the bus today told me they don't take it on weekends because they don't want to use the call-in system. I didn't ask them their age, but I would guess they're older than all of us here. And one of them explained. She said, you know, I call for a bus on Sunday, and wherever I am, then maybe I decide I want to walk to the next location, but I've already booked the bus to come pick me up. Or maybe I want, somebody else offers me a ride, and I feel responsible to call the number and leave a message. It's just not as easy. And at yesterday's meeting, I heard the comment about not, oh, we're providing wonderful, better, improved service, but rather we're saving, what was it, $270,000. That should never be the driving decision for changing the bus service. Buses, yes. Jim Madsen spoke about that years ago. We got to get these buses working better and cheaper when they were all, what do you call that, not digital.
Diesel.
Diesel, thank you. I'm not into that very much. That we keep in mind the service, and that all these years that I've lived here, I only ever heard one complaint about bus service costing too much money. Buses, yes, or they didn't like the smell, or they didn't like the noise, or whatever. Or they thought they were running empty, which probably a lot of them are. I don't know. I didn't study that. I just think the board needs to ask for more studies where you have a hard copy in front of you showing you exactly what's happening with different situations. But I do hope you'll consider maybe instead of spending this money on the tennis building, spending it on phase one of Clubhouse One. A lot more people use Clubhouse One than use the tennis clubhouse. Thank you.
We are doing an assessment of Clubhouse One.
Yes.
It's going on right now.
We're doing, right.
Pat English.
No, Pat, no. Wait, Judith has had her hand up. Judith.
Oh, I'm sorry.
The tennis building really does need help. So I'm all for that. As far as the planner, right, when we used to have 250 bus riders a day for the fixed route, now that planner rides come in, the ridership is 400 a day between the two. The ridership for the fixed route have gone down to about 200, and the other 200 is using the planner ride. So every day, fixed route riders are going down and planner rides going up. And the other thing to look at, hundreds of people who've never ridden any bus before are just using planner ride, and they've never used any bus before, so they don't have anything to compare it to. But more and more people, as the demographics change, are just automatically starting with plan a ride and using that only. So that's sort of what the data that staff is looking at when we decide. But we'd like six more buses. So would I. But we're trying to manage that here. But I was happy with the four.
Okay, Annette.
On Clubhouse One, these are some of the improvements we made in 2018. This Clubhouse One, HVAC replacement, $350,000, maintenance, $50,000. The renovation assessment to see what further needs to be done to that building is $80,000. Clubhouse One energy management system along with 3 and 5 is $150,000. The chairs were $40,000 and the shower boiler was $12,000, making it $682,000 that was spent on it this year. We are anticipating getting back that assessment and then looking at it, and I believe that that was some of the reason that the board decided to dial back a little bit on the pack to make sure we had stuff in reserve. So when we got back that assessment, we could appropriately react then to that report. Thank you.
Right. Okay. Okay, now Pat.
Pat English, 2022D. I just wanted to say, as far as what Maxine had said about Clubhouse One, that I agree with her. That we don't have anything on for this year, is that right? We have all that money on from last year, but not for this year. And it's a big deal, Clubhouse One. It's the oldest clubhouse that we have, and the sooner we get things taken care of there, the better I think we're going to be. I think we should be putting more money into Clubhouse One and less into PAC. That's my opinion. And the second thing I would like to say is with regard to the golf course. Now, I'm a firm believer that golf course brings a lot of very qualified people to Laguna Woods, and it's a very good selling point for our properties and everything else. However, if we're using all recycled water on it, then we're going to have problems with our turf because it's recycled water that's got excessive salt in it, and that's going to cause a lot of problems. I think we need to be looking at an alternative where we can water down that that type of water, and it will do less damage to our golf course. Thank you very much.
Good point.
Dick Rader, 270D. On page 11, which is the reserves plan, if you look at the first column in green, how realistic is this reserve plan? Everything holds pretty steady, but then the trend is, through all the years, go down. I don't understand that in terms of expenditures and what the future holds. I mean, labor goes up, materials go up, tariffs go up. Kidding about the tariffs. But how do we justify those numbers?
Well, these are our reserves. It's not our operating. It's only our reserves.
I know, but
but that was what I was saying yesterday, is that when we talk about renovating the Performing Arts Center, we're not spending that money every year. We're doing it, and then in 20 years or 30 years, we'll do it again. And so that's why, I think that's why some of this, there are some years where we don't spend as much.
You're saving for future years' projects, or you're spending a lot of money on one project, like when you see these big dips, like you see out maybe, 2044. You know, there's something big we're doing there, and it's using a lot of resources.
Are you comfortable with this, Betty? Those types of numbers, where the numbers just hold steady and then go drastically down?
Yes, because there's dozens and dozens of components behind this reserves plan, and each component has a life cycle. And so it's not like an operating budget where you see a consistent level of expenditure every year. It just depends on the age and life of the asset.
Yeah. Okay.
I know.
Hi, thanks. I think there's a misconception on some people's part on what reserves are there for. And from time to time, you're going to have to dip into the reserve. That's a tool that's there for immediate use if you need it. And people have got to realize that. Another thing the staff did this year is they identified all the requirements up front. They did all the contracts up front, which meant that work started earlier. What that does is it gives you more flexibility at the end. So if you need to extend something, you can do it. Okay? And one way you do it is if you're in a project, you take some money out of the reserves to do it, or you increase the assessments. So there's a balance you got to do between these two. But you got to remember that another tool is just your reserves. If you need to dip into it, you dip into it. That's what it's there for. But the main reason why I'm up here talking is I want to show my appreciation to all the boards for not only looking at current year, next year out, but long-range planning. This affords the opportunity to do studies in advance, to go out and actually look at something. Take a shovel, dig down, look at pillars and things like that, see if there is dry rot. That's something that has not been done in the past. And the boards now are doing that. And I think people need to be aware of that and be very happy that the boards are doing that. I know I am. Thanks a lot.
Kind of to piggyback on that, I know Annette listed off a number of the things that have happened with Clubhouse One this year, and then look, and people are concerned, why aren't we starting Clubhouse One? What are we doing? It's so important. We're into the destructive testing part of that, so we can know exactly what needs to be done. So we are moving along with Clubhouse One. So I think, and of course, Brad, I'm sure, can explain this really well, we're not doing just one project, okay, that's done, now we'll do this project. We're doing a project, starting another, overlapping type projects.
It's important, Maxine, that's a really good question you posed. We have to do this assessment first. We want to know as much as we can about that building. And then in 2021, we've planned $500,000 for, if you look at our five-year plan, for the design of all the improvements there. And so we would hire an architectural firm. The anticipation is either you're going to be building a brand new facility there, or you're going to be remodeling the facility you have, or more likely, you might remodel a part and rebuild a part. I think that's the most likely scenario. And so you're going to need a pretty heavy set of architectural plans to do that. And so that's why those resources are allocated out in a year or two. And then, though it fell out of the five-year plan, it probably hits that last year where we had $5 million programmed in there. Each 2 years. Yeah, so a total of $10 million allocated in the plan for Clubhouse One. In my opinion, I love that building. I hope we can save every bit of it that we can. But we'll have to see what the assessment comes back. But I believe to remodel that whole thing will cost every bit of $10 million.
Oh, yeah.
And probably more.
More.
Yep. And so we'll see. We'll get the assessment back later this year. We'll bring it to the MNC and we'll kick it around. And then I suspect they'll have recommendations for the full board.
Okay, Diane.
And I just want to say we're doing things a little bit differently in that in the old days, we used to say now, okay, let's put $10 million and let's take it out of our reserves or earmark it for Clubhouse One. And we're not doing that. We're trying to wait until we actually are going to, are thinking we realistically will spend it.
And well, we'd like to realistically know how much we're spending, too, because
right.
Sometimes in the past...
We just would pick a number.
We just kind of swag. And I don't mind a good swag, but I'd like to have a little bit of data to base it on. And so I think this assessment gives us an opportunity to make educated guesses rather than just guessing entirely.
The motion that's on the floor that we will be voting on is that we accept staff's recommendation for business plan for 2019. All those in favor? It's unanimous. Thank you.
Thank you again, and we will have a resolution for your consideration at your next meeting.
We are now on number 7 on the agenda, board member comments. And I'm going to start with Jim Mattson, our chair of our MNC committee.
I'm real pleased. Sounds everything fine with me.
I think we've done it again, came together, and got a good package here.
Dick.
No comment.
Annette.
I really want to thank everyone for their hard work to make this possible, all the chairs of all the committees and BMS, everyone. It really took a lot to do this, and I think we all have a greater understanding about it. Thank you.
Diane, okay. Ray?
Yeah, a good program as far as I'm concerned. It's well thought of and well proposed.
Okay, I'm going to go way over there to Betty. Siobhan, Bert, Judith.
I just want to remind everybody, I called a special mobility and vehicles televised meeting August 31st, 9:30 in this room, and the only thing on the agenda is to evaluate alternative transportation options, and yes, we will talk money.
The people on the bus today said they have big bus plans for that day.
And the ones
I've
who
already
don't,
spread the word.
The ones who don't drive like to take those trips. August 31st, were they correct? Two of them said that there's a big trip plan for that day for bus riders.
Well, that's why it's televised. Oh. That's why I'm having it televised. For those
they
that can't
be here for the meeting.
Correct.
Are you suggesting these bus riders are going to go to an Angels game as opposed to complain on a bus, as opposed to come here and complain
they
about
didn't
the bus?
Think, they didn't think it was an Angels game, is it?
No, you might be. I don't know. Is it?
It's as good as anything.
No, it's not an Angels game.
Well,
I'm sorry.
It sounds
it
good.
It might just be a shopping trip.
It's the Dodgers.
There you go.
I know that Diane has something to share.
I was just going to say, so tomorrow at the same time at 1:30 is United's budget.
Friday at 9:30 is third.
Okay.
Okay, then my comment is this was an excellent plan, well well thought out, very professional, and such hard work by so many people. And thank you for a wonderful presentation. Appreciate it. And this meeting is adjourned.